tonight is Monday night, June 13th. It is at 6:31. All board members are present, as well as the health agent and the secretary. I'm going to start the meeting.
Donna, can I say that I will be taping my own for references?
Okay.
Thank you.
So Gail McSweeney will be using her own audio recording for this meeting, but as the chairman's statement, please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through an audio recording, which will be used to ensure an accurate recording of proceedings produced in the minutes, and all comments made in open session will be recorded. I would also like to state that Rob from Pembroke Town News, which is a new YouTube station, has once again joined us, so you can follow the meeting live, recorded on YouTube. I really want to kind of go directly into what we have here. We have signed the payroll. Our minutes of the meeting from the last meeting are not available due to the extensiveness of the recording. So those will be made available to us as soon as everything can be deciphered correctly and accurately. I have a lot of correspondence. I, as the chairperson, will be considering any item that comes into me by email or by mail that is pertinent to the Board of Health as a group. I will be reading them as correspondence every time we have a meeting. The first one came in late this afternoon that you all have in your box. After talking with Lisa Cullity, as well as town council, for email system that the Board of Health is going to adopt. I know that we all have our own email accounts.
Sorry,
we now have specific email addresses through the town of Pembroke, so that everything is on the server.
Now, how is this set up? We just go on to our email address, and then how is it set up for a password?
Well, the password, all accounts are now set, Gail, right under the second, first part of it.
No,
right.
If I may, it's a little more complicated than that. I have the following emails: Donna Bagney at bostonconnect.com, Gary Fine at Fine GDF Comcast, Gary Fine, Fine GDF at Gmail, Gail McSweeney, 5557. I'm not going to put the whole thing, but these, you will confirm these are all active emails for you? Yes?
Correct.
The URL to log into the remote access server, which supports the entire town of Pembroke's email, is a very long one, so I've extended a hyperlink so you can merely click on it and then create your own shortcut so you don't have to type it in. It is literally the whole length of a page with wise and typing. Once you log in, you will then reset your password. The password for everyone is the same. I'm obviously not going to read that out loud right now, but it is clearly indicated in the email.
And that is a zero, not a no.
Correct. And then everyone's name, it's the same for every employee and every person within the town that has an email account. It's the first letter of their first name, their last name, at townofpembrokemass.org. That will eliminate any confusion. Everyone will be able to email anyone. Anyone who wants to email someone with the town, obviously, just by knowing their name, would then know their email address with the town to be able to do so.
Okay.
And again, the reason to email you these on your personal account is only so you have this hyperlink, rather than type out literally, what is this, 70-something character URL. And then, of course, once you log on to that URL, every computer, every smartphone has the ability to create a one-touch quick link or a shortcut, depending on what platform you're on, so you will not have to type that ever again. Once you reset your password, you will not have your password. No one will have your password unless you give it to them.
Mm-hmm.
The only people who can ever access your email account is HubTech. They can access everyone's email account from the entire town of Pembroke.
Okay. Perfect.
Point of clarity.
Correct.
I know we had a discussion at our board meeting last Monday, the 6th, and there was some talk, I think it might have been initiated by you, about having your own email. At this juncture, I would prefer not to use this newly created email for me, and would like to, you can still call both of you, and you, if that's okay,
You don't have to use it, it's been created for you, it is completely at your choice.
So you can correspond, and I can, I will email you rather than having...
She'll have it from the same email, though.
Okay.
The email that I just sent out, linking everyone to the new email.
Yep.
Use it or don't use it, it is your choice.
It's just gonna be the difference of changing our regular email or utilizing this one just for the town.
Correct.
And if you wanna utilize it, that's...
I have multiple email addresses, I don't need another one.
Yes, you do, correct.
So,
My, it came up in our last meeting, my email has become, is my business, I don't use a Comcast. I haven't opened that account in a year. So I need to clean out that, and I think that it's important that everything is separated. So I choose to use my DonnaBagney@townofpembrokemass.org. If you do not choose to use it, just make sure that I have it, because I'll create a group with those emails in it, so I just type in Pembroke Board of Health, and all of you, all the emails come up, and off we go. So that's one of the correspondence. The second correspondence that's up for discussion, or that I want to read, is the one that came through from Ed Thorne. I think I popped it in there somewhere, it should have been, yep, that one. Ed Thorne did send me an email through today at 3:32. Dear Board of Health member, it has come to my attention that Town Council has been copied on emails circulated among and directed to certain members of the Board of Health. Please be advised that it is the Board of Selectmen's policy that all requests to correspond with Town Council must be cleared with the Town Administrator in advance. This came to light because you will see several other correspondences that are coming up that happen to have responses where Town Council was added to them after the last meeting that we had. So that, therefore, has triggered the next, correspondence that I've numbered 2 and 3.
So as of the last meeting on June 6th, this is when this arose?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, and I think I've given everybody threads, so you'll have the opportunity to go through, and we can put them back on the agenda for another time if you want to further discuss.
Do you happen to know, and you might not, I know that I have had some email correspondence with Town Council after our meeting on the 6th in
correct.
Regards to the responses to the Attorney General.
Correct, and that is what we're paying her to do. But any erroneous emails that she happens to be put on does happen to incur a cost of attorney fees, even by her opening and reading an email.
Sure.
While it may not have anything to do with her, her dealings with you.
That's fine.
Correct.
Okay. Thank
until you.
Until you
have the final
yep.
word from the
okay.
Attorney General.
Thank you.
The one thing I wanted to question, as a Board of Health, I did get a correspondence from Gail Monday night after that meeting that you unfortunately were working and couldn't attend. It was Monday, June 6th at 9:19. The question proposed is, where are the meeting minutes? Just want to make sure what minutes and... Do you have them?
No, when I went out on under the meeting minutes, it was a bunch of laws. It wasn't, the meeting minutes weren't posted on the website.
From which meeting?
I went to look up, it had to be the one prior. I'd have to go get my phone.
The one prior?
It would have to be the one prior.
If you could just check into that and
yep.
just get back to me.
Yep.
Because I want to find out what meetings minutes you didn't have.
Okay.
And then the other thing are just the next question that was asked, why are there so many errors in dates and postings? If you wouldn't mind just giving me a heads up so that I know what we have going on.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Donna Bagney, the chairperson. Are you here for...
Charlie Matheson, I'm here from WATD. I'm really for downstairs.
Oh, okay. So I just want, because we're recording...
Slow news night, so you decided to wander up here, sir?
Lisa, I go where they send me.
Sounds Sounds good.
So if we can just clarify this, Gail, I just want to make sure that we address it.
Question, as chair, is it your, I don't believe it is, I'm asking, is it your responsibility to ensure that the minutes are posted on the website?
Well, if we go to item number one, which is the process of the Board of Health meeting minutes, which is right here, I've circled it in with a one, because that goes with that email. This is how the processing of the Board of Health meeting minutes are done. They're transcribed by a written and recorded means. Once written, a copy is sent to the board member and the health agent for his review and or revision if necessary. When the revisions are made, a revised copy is sent to everyone mentioning above to ensure that the changes are correct to the best of their knowledge. Upon the okay of each member, the minutes are entered into the Board of Health meeting for voting approval. Assigned approved minutes are then posted to the town's website. Here is the website. They can be found within the Board of Health page on the lower right-hand side under the topic of the minutes. Simply click and date you wish to receive. So basically, if we had a meeting 2 weeks before June 6th, Carol, correct me if I'm wrong, those meeting minutes were actually approved on the 6th. So once we approved them, then they were up for posting.
They were on the website the next day.
The next day. So they wouldn't have been on previous to our meeting on June 6th because they hadn't been approved.
The meeting for June 6th?
Right. So the meeting prior.
May 16th.
Thank you.
May 16th.
Minutes of the meetings were given to us June 6th. To be approved.
Right.
Once they are approved, then they are put on the website.
Okay.
So at 9 o'clock, I had actually just gotten home at 8:30 that night. So when the secretary comes back in, gets the approved minutes of the meeting, they would have been up on the website by Tuesday, June 7th?
Yes.
Okay. So that's how that goes.
I gotta get my phone and look at.
Right, all the minutes are up to date and online May 16th, April 11th, March 21st, March 7th. If you click view all, it'll take you back to the last 2 years. They're all there. I just looked through really quickly.
Perfect.
All the minutes that have been approved are online and available.
Perfect.
Don't
all agendas are online and available.
Okay.
What I was asking was, and these procedures are pretty much what we've been doing for the last 2 years since
yes,
I've been on
have.
The board. It is not, and I don't think it should be, but it's not your responsibility. It's the office that is responsible for posting, and,
yes,
and you're
is.
Not.
I don't have time to go back
nor,
and check.
Nor
and
should you. That's
double check somebody's
right.
job. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got
but
it.
That's how the process works.
But again, we cannot post any minutes until the board has voted to accept them. If they're
right.
not accepted minutes, they are draft format only. Therefore, it should not be made available to the public in anything but a draft. And obviously, for website purposes, you don't want to be putting up minutes, taking them down, putting them up, taking it down. That creates confusion.
Mm-hmm. And errors.
Have occurred.
Errors. We're human. I made a comment 2 weeks ago. We are learning adults. Even though we have spell check, sometimes we still make mistakes. So I'd like to go on to correspondence number two. This is something that keeps going back and forth, and I think it was a miscommunication. The first thing that I had asked the secretary was, what was the selectmen's summer schedule? Because in previous years, we have followed their schedule during the summertime so that we aren't here on a night by ourselves using electricity and air conditioning and whatnot. So I had asked for the selectmen's agenda summer schedule so that we could discuss, as we always do, if we want to follow the schedule. I think what happened when I sent it was it's an item that will be part of our discussion for the next meeting. Gail, question, the Board of Selectmen have no authority over the Board of Health. All meetings going forward are to be and will be set by the Board of Health. That is a correct statement.
they are all set by the Board of Health.
Okay.
Okay. And then I think you were also, again, please provide me with the law that you are abiding by that places the selectman in charge of the Board of Health.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that that, and correct me if I'm wrong, was just a miscommunication, misunderstanding of what my intent of looking at the summer schedule
correct.
For the selectman was.
Correct.
Okay. Then the next one that came through on the 9th is you were requesting the duties of the health agent employees
mm-hmm.
to be placed on the agenda and to be provided by all Board of Health members for June 13th. You weren't asking for a discussion, but you were seeking an understanding of the employee's duties.
Correct.
With that being said, because they are employees, it's not that I did not want to give you their job descriptions. That's under wage and personnel, so it has to follow a chain of command. That was sent up to Sabrina,
mm-hmm.
Who then, I believe, got you exactly and also included the health, public health nurses.
No, she did give me the information. My question at this point, though, is, with the information that I received in my first packet on Board of Health duties, one of them is the hazardous waste days, the hazardous waste day, and that is actually under the selectmen. So I really want to make sure that we've got clarity of who's supposed to be responsible for what, because that was under the Mass Board of Health directive, and I don't know if I got that with me. I might.
Okay, well, I'm going to add that definitely
okay.
as an agenda item.
Please do.
Because we can explore that in complete detail.
I can actually give you a full explanation right now.
Okay.
The Board of Health permits the activities at the recycling and transfer station. And transfer station, when I say transfer station, it is a single dumpster. It is an authority given by DEP to license any small-scale transfer station under, and I don't quote me on this, 30,000 yards or something like that annually, which we fall well underneath. So we license a permit and oversee the operation, but since the town has chosen to hire Michael Blente to run the transfer station, he has taken over the day-to-day duties and operations. Yes, but this board wishes not to have hazardous waste day canceled.
But isn't Michael Blente under the Board of Health?
He's under the Board of Selectmen, but he works with us, and he works both.
But the Board of Health, we put out application for employment. He was hired by
correct.
The board, so why would he be the Board of Selectmen?
I've never had an issue if you're asking for care.
See, this is the part, Donna, where we're crossing lines and it's getting very confusing.
Okay, so
okay.
That would be a great question, I think, for Ed Thorne.
Okay, and this is on what you gave me with the required duties of the local Board of Health in my first packet, in my
mm-hmm.
first meeting. And I was very involved with this, so I do know regulations, the government regulations
mm-hmm.
on this.
Okay.
I've worked with government regulations for 20 years.
Okay. So that may be a good clarification between the town administrator and the Board of Health. So Sabrina Chilcott would be the best person to address that question too, so that it can become more clarity. Then I think that we should add it, if you'd like.
Okay,
we can
yeah.
add
would you
it
add that? As Madam Chair, would you add that?
Okay. One of the reasons I did not change my agenda the what I came up with, because as a chairperson, I am responsible for creating the agenda. The reason I did not put this agenda request for their contracts or their job duties on the agenda, because it's not open for discussion, their job descriptions. If I put it on the agenda, then it has to be a discussion.
Right.
We were not going to discuss.
And that's what,
right.
at the very first, out of the gate, that's why I contacted you and said,
yep.
okay, I want to review different records.
Yeah.
Because it's not something that should be ever discussed in an open meeting.
Correct.
Ever.
Exactly. So if I put it on the agenda, then I'd have to discuss it.
Exactly.
And I.
And now we're in violation, so.
You got it. So therefore, it went perfectly, went to Sabrina, you got what you needed.
Fabulous.
Okay. And number the next page, which is marked 2 and 3, corresponds to correspondence 2 and 3, that each member is asked
to list any topic he or she wishes to discuss in the future. Last page in your files is a blank line sheet of paper. Please feel free to put your name on it. Fill out what items you'd like to add. I feel, as a board, we need to start talking about the tobacco products, topics, any future topics to be discussed. There is one thing I want to note, that no Board of Health paperwork, other than what's in your folder and what any of us is given, is to leave this office at any time. I'd like to give my fellow board members an update on PTAB as a future topic. I am the Board of Health representative for the Pembroke Titans Against Drugs. I sit on the executive board along with the fire, public nurse, police, school committee members, and we are actively involved in the non-profit organization that it has been created.
Have you seen up on the North Shore, there was a town that did, if the residents, if somebody was having problems, they walked in with their drugs, gave the drugs over, and said, I want help. What the sheriff has done is found facilities for them to be put into. They said
we
that they've
had... We have not gotten to that...
To that level?
...organization yet. We've only... We're in the infancy.
I was pretty impressed by the stats.
For about 2 years. Yeah.
Within a year, 1 year, 400 people they had come through.
If you have those stats, I'd love to tell you
sure.
when the next PTAB meeting is. Because
okay.
that, I think, would be something, if you came and presented that, something they could work towards. Because that's a huge, wonderful...
That, to me, was
an
extremely positive move, because for us to lock these kids up, to send them to jail, they're going to come back out. They're associating with the same people.
Mm-hmm.
And adults,
yep.
the veterans, my daughter's a veteran, my husband's a veteran, and I have seen so much.
Right.
These kids coming home from overseas are dying,
right.
they're not getting the right mental health.
Exactly. And mental health is a complete different...
it is.
You know, this is trying to get the children under the age of 18, and
yep.
I'm sorry, they're not... children, they're young adults, but to make awareness to the parents of what we're dealing with in regards to opioids and heroin and the process of how we can help that group
right.
as much as we'd like to help everybody else. The other thing is there's a lot of talk about legalizing marijuana possibly on a November ballot. So I
now,
think that's important.
Can you bring me up to speed where we were? Because the last time that I heard anything about legalizing marijuana, they were going to have a dispensary in Pembroke. Is that happening or is it not?
At this point, I don't have that answer.
Okay.
Chairman, a party has come forward that has expressed interest and asked for informal sit-downs with the Board of Selectmen to ask if the Board of Selectmen and or the town would be opposed to a dispensary in Pembroke. No formal application has been put forward. It was an informal request by one individual.
And this is it, legalizing it in regards to recreational, not medical.
Oh, this is...
This applicant was interested in medical.
Right. This is what's coming on the agenda, I believe, for the state of Massachusetts, is they're trying to get it on the ballot as legalization for recreation.
Well, that's going to have a lot of
coming.
Slippery slopes
right.
on
so
it.
So we've got a lot to talk about.
Yeah, that's
okay.
going
to
happen. Lisa, did somebody come before the Board of Selectmen, or did somebody just pop in?
An informal request.
And how is, do you know,
I do not
the Board of
Selectmen? I do not know the status of that request at this time. I do not know if the Board of Selectmen has heard it. It could be hearing it tonight.
Thank you.
Okay. And then the last is, in the event that one of us cannot be here, I have included, per the rules and regulations, we have adopted and allow for phone-in.
Mm-hmm.
This is just how the process goes about in regards to the fact that if a member cannot be here, if a member cannot be here and two other members can be here, then there is a vote.
There is a meeting.
There is a meeting.
Yeah.
Okay, so that...
I do, where we had meeting that was unscheduled, and I had been on vacation in Eggertown the week before,
mm-hmm.
I found a lot of
Are you talking about the selectmen's meeting?
Between the selectmen's and the Board of Health's meeting.
Yeah.
I already had prior commitments for that time.
I understand. And with the one, so now what we need to understand is the fact that there were legal complaints filed against both you and myself.
I understand.
The rules pertaining to those complaints is they have to be answered in 14 days. So there would not have been enough time.
Correct.
For us to get legal counsel here for this meeting. So we had to have the meeting last
Monday. No, I totally understand that. I did not object to that at all.
And
I just told you that I was unable to do it.
Exactly. And what the, how the selectmen went about their job is nothing to do with me.
Okay.
I was able to attend because I knew I was on the complaint. So I felt I should
Most definitely.
Hear what they had to say. So,
most definitely.
With that being said, I'm going to go right to the...
Can I interject?
Yeah, of course you can.
You had mentioned, Gail, the unscheduled meeting. Now, when we met on the 16th, we did not have June 6th as a meeting scheduled.
Correct.
But you as chair, when you called that meeting, Donna, it was probably about, I'm guessing, a little short of a week before the 6th. So it wasn't an unscheduled meeting. You just called the meeting.
Well, it was an unscheduled meeting from our board meeting. From what we said here as a board, it was an unscheduled meeting.
Okay. Semantics. The meeting wasn't scheduled at our last meeting. But the
Correct.
Chair isn't
But the board.
Scheduled. The chair is entitled to schedule a meeting, and you did call that meeting
legally,
for the 6th.
Legally, I had to call it. I actually could have called it and said, you know, Tuesday night. Monday night after the board, after the selectmen's meeting, I could have, well, no, I'm sorry, I'm incorrect. You have to have 48 hours notice. So I could have called it for Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. Let both of you know. If you could come and you couldn't come, I could, you know, that's responsibility. But this had legal ramifications.
I just wouldn't call it unscheduled. It was unscheduled from our meeting on the 16th, but as chair, Donna is entitled to schedule a meeting as long as we have 14.
Well, now you're going potatoes, patatas here, Gary, because the scheduled meeting is determined by the board at their meeting for the next meeting. Okay.
Okay.
Now, we're in light of the fact the health agent wasn't going to be here on the 6th, I had an opportunity to go to Edgartown for the week, and
Absolutely.
I went.
I'm not questioning that you were here
so,
or not here.
No, but what I'm saying is it was not something that I was aware of, that I had the time that was going to be set aside for, that we agreed in unison that we would be together. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So when we set a meeting as a board and something comes up, no, she's going to schedule it, but in the terms of whether or not was it a scheduled meeting between the board at the last meeting? No, it was not.
No, I agree. But she almost, when you had said unscheduled meeting, I take it as Donna can schedule a meeting. That's all.
But there was no, we didn't have any conflicts with that.
I'm making a point. I didn't feel it was an unscheduled meeting. That's
okay.
All I'm saying.
All right. Moving
so
along.
Okay. Unless we have anything else to say on that, I'd like to go right into, Lisa, we have, we're running a little behind 65
yes.
Plain Street.
And you could not be here, Carol. You stopped in earlier.
Yes, that's right.
And did you give you the exact measurement?
Yes, are you right on the sheet of paper?
Yeah.
Right here.
Thank
exact
you. Very nice gentleman. And his, I'm sorry, his daughter had a award ceremony tonight. He had every intention of being here. He has an existing deck. It is over a concrete slab. To try and get footings through the concrete slab would necessitate him bringing an excavator or some other larger piece of equipment and or jackhammering it out. So he'd like to extend his deck so that the footings go just beyond that, so he does not have to do that. He has a very small deck that is not working for him. The problem is that he will encroach beyond the 10 feet setback that is required for his septic tank. He is requesting that, given the extenuating circumstances, that the board allow him a variance to be 8 feet away from the tank instead of 10. Not because he's just trying to be grandiose or difficult, but because of the cost of trying to remove this concrete slab, plus not do damage to this area, obviously bringing in heavy equipment next to a septic tank. He asked the board to consider allowing him an 8-foot variance instead of 10 feet so that he could build his deck without incurring all those additional pieces of work, expense, and possible damage to his tank.
Have you been out there, Lisa?
I have. It's close, but it's no closer than some of the other folks that have had the exact same problem that we've allowed it for. Obviously, we don't allow digging within 10 feet of a septic tank at a careless thought because of the danger that can occur, but he's digging these footings by hand. He understands the risk he'll be taking, and he's taking responsibility for it. The other option is, of course, then he has to bring in heavy equipment, and that'll obviously raise the cost of him putting on his deck substantially.
Sorry, he's done that.
The board's under no obligation to give the variance. It is just that, a variance and exception to the rules. That's at the discretion of this board.
When you say that he's taking responsibility if there's any damage done.
In other words, if he does any damage, he will repair it. He understands that this isn't a license to do as he will.
Was that just a conversation they had, or
yes,
is this?
Yes, okay. We had a lengthy conversation. He was trying to explore all the opportunities he had. He actually came up here two or three different times trying to figure out a different solution. But apparently this concrete pad, he dug down beside it. It's almost a foot thick. I mean, it's going to take a substantial amount of work to try to hammer out footings to bring those footings within that 10-foot mark, and probably heavy equipment to do so. So it's a cost factor. It's an excavation factor. He really wanted to exhaust every opportunity before he tried to actually remove part of or all of this concrete slab.
Sure. Anybody have any further discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask for a motion?
All motion.
Okay. As stated, usually you can just say as stated on the plan.
It's actually not written out, so if it's the will of the board, the variance would be to allow, instead of the mandatory 10-foot setback for a footing from a septic tank, to allow a variance down to 8 feet of separation from the septic tank. That would be the motion, should you wish to make it.
Okay.
It's a septic tank.
Mm-hmm.
It's a septic tank.
Yep.
You know? Yeah, make a motion to pass.
Okay. So if you'll make a motion, do I have a second?
I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next. 42 Blueberry Lane is up.
Yeah, I think he wanted to attend, but I did not see him. That does not mean he's not here now. Received a new septic system just a couple years ago. I'm sorry, I'm looking for the date. Yeah, 2011. At the time, this house was owned in a family trust, to the best of my knowledge, and now that trust has shifted. And in so shifting, control and ownership of the house has changed. Now the family member in ownership / control of the home wishes to take down the existing house there, which is not in the best of shape, and build a new home. The reason the board needs to be willing to give a variance for this is when this repair was done, it was done for a two-bedroom home, and it was done with a reduction. And the reduction was from 150 gallons a day down to 110, which is a totally normal reduction, as the board's aware, especially when we're dealing with these tight pond neighborhoods. However, this would be substandard for new construction. The house is already deed restricted. He understands, and he's only building a two-bedroom home. He is not asking to extend or add additional bedrooms. However, to the letter of the code, the reason I can't sign his building permit is he did ask for the reduction, which is for an existing home only, and now to build a new home, code would state that he needs to bring it up to code. He is asking the board for relief from that, to keep his new septic system that was built with reductions, yet be allowed to build a new home. And of course, the only way he can do that is if the board chooses to give him a variance to that code.
Just let the gentleman come right here.
This is Mr. Pat?
Oh.
He's the next.
Okay.
Okay.
So Mr. Pratt, he...
Pat. That's me. I was mispronouncing
myself. That's okay. So Mr. Pratt understands that he'll build a new home, but it will be a two-bedroom.
The deed restriction is in place. He acknowledges all that. Again, I can't sign off because his house is not fully up to where the code would say it would be. Pembroke's local upgrade regulations require 150 gallons a day per bedroom. And when the engineer designed this, he took the reduction because it was allowed. It's an existing two-bedroom home. The reason of not making this bigger, the first comment should be, well, why didn't he just make it the whole size? Because he didn't want to make an H20 loaded. This already had to come up. There's very high groundwater in the Blueberry Lane area, for those not familiar with it. The pond is right here, and he wanted to maintain parking here. By bringing it up and H20 loading it, this would come up even more. He'd like to have a ramp up onto his parking and then like a ramp down to his house. That is why reducing it and keeping it over here maintained his level parking area. And the necessity to bring it up wasn't there, so that's why it is.
What's the reduction again? 150 to what?
150 to 110 gallons per day per bedroom of water flow.
So the variance that we're considering, it's kind of duplicitous because we've already granted that variance way back when.
However, the variance is now to allow them to construct a new home, even though we know it's not compliant with what would be new construction rules. It's an unusual situation. The decision was made to save money when the house wasn't really in his care and control. Now the property is. So he can't go back and undo what was done before.
And it was in the, it was the family. You mentioned the trust.
It's unclear. He said it's in control of the family. Maybe the trust is the wrong word, but it was not in his whole care and control. Mm-hmm. Now it is.
Now it is. So now he wants...
Now he wishes to build it, construct it.
Could be some... Right.
The advice of builders is this house is not really rehabable, redoable, to be as functional as a home would be today. I mean, it could be done, but he'll actually spend more money than new construction, which is not uncommon. Especially with the summer cottages.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, but I feel that if he is going to put up a brand new home, then it needs to be in compliance.
And that's the rule of the board.
The rules are. I mean, that is my position. But anybody else want to talk about it?
Yeah. I'm hearing this for the first time. I'm not sure if I 100% agree with you. I don't believe I was a part of the board when...
No, you would not.
Yeah,
no,
when correct. He was granted, and when I say he, it might have been mm-hmm. the trust, they were initially granted.
I do not remember who came in full honesty. I do not believe it was him. I do not know. I think the engineer came in. I do not believe a member of the family came in with the engineer when presenting this plan.
We granted, again, we, not you and I, the board, he was given a variance, and again, he, probably the family, was given a variance way mm-hmm. back when. I don't necessarily have an objection of, I don't want to say forcing him, but we passed it once, and I'm not sure if we need to go back up to 150, so
right. Well, we have a reduction, and the other thing that I'm concerned about is the fact that we are sitting directly
on the
waterfront, two Stetson Pond.
Valid concern.
Yep.
And that does concern me. You know, I'm just giving you my opinion. We can table it for another time if you would like to think about it.
I think especially with the water frontage, I think that maybe some more information should probably be.
What additional information would you like? Because there's really not going to be any additional information forthcoming here. He wants to build a brand new house, and he doesn't want to have to upgrade the septic system where it's new. He wants to leave it just as is. There's one or two options to the board. Either, no, I will not sign your building permit until you bring it up to 150 gallons per day per bedroom, as our code would apply for new construction, or no, I will allow it to sit as it is. There's nothing else really to consider there. The system's in the ground. It's the maximum setback from the pond it can be. It's not going to be a whole new system. It's not going to be moved, so it'll be a matter of that. If there's another question, I can certainly try and get some more information here.
45 blueberries.
Is it a fairly...
So...
It's not a new septic.
It's 5 years old.
Yeah. It's very new. Yeah. It's pretty dash gone, though.
5 years old. I just have a problem about setting a precedent. Because now if we do it for one person,
it's
then we're going to have to do it for other people.
any house is...
And Blueberry Lane is a problematic area, because there's...
All of them. Most of the tanks, septic has had to be redone down there.
Yep.
The original summer cottages, all the ones.
I take that back, all but two, one is uninhabited, and one alone that is inhabited only in the summer remains unupgraded. Every other house on the street has gone to upgrade. The first house on that street, as you pull down, has never been occupied. In my knowledge of that property, the one at the very end is also not upgraded, which is occupied for 6 weeks in the summer.
I certainly don't think it's a case of double jeopardy here, but, you know, given the fact that the septic is just 5 years young, for the board to, again, maybe reversing its decision isn't the appropriate language, but we have granted many, many variances over the years. After carefully looking at each and every one of them, I don't necessarily feel that he should have to go through the expense of updating a septic, but that's, we can agree to disagree.
Not with it being 5 years old, with it already in place. I didn't realize that. I mean, if we were talking about something that had already been, was 20 years old or 25 years old, then I would most definitely, but 5 years old?
If discussion is done, do I hear a motion?
Yeah, I'll make a motion on 42 Blueberry Lane that we accept the variances as requested by the homeowner, Mr. Pat, to build a new two-bedroom home, keeping the 110 pumping,
110 gallon
per day that we agreed years ago. Boy, that was a motion.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
I deny, but so whatever you want to call that. I vote no.
Okay.
Okay, but it passes, so Mr. Pat is all set. Okay, Phillips Road. Another on the water.
Yes. This one's very difficult because this one sits on Great Sandy Pond. It owns land on both sides of the road, and it is sandwiched between both water bodies. If you had a perfect storm with nowhere to go,
it's got way too much in it.
So, Great Sandy Pond, surface water supply, Furnace Pond is a tributary to a water supply. This is the homeowner's house. This is the homeowner's proposed septic system. This is the homeowner's other dog-leg parcel that goes across to the other pond. So
dog-leg parcel?
Dog-leg. It's not a straight
dog-leg.
Parcel.
Dog-leg. Excuse me.
Dog-leg.
I'm not as hip as you are. Dog-leg. Dog-leg.
He does not have a dog. He does not have a dog-leg in the ground. So setback, there's a whole bunch of variances. Carol, I will try to be... Fantastic, excellent. So setback from the homeowner's private well supply, because this is private water out there, from 100 feet to 82 feet. Setback reduction from Furnace Pond, tributary to water supply, from 200 feet to 156. Setback from tank to the same body of water from 200 to 140. He'll allow the setback and reduction from Great Sandy Pond, a surface water supply, and the septic tank and SAS from 400 feet required to 100 and 103 feet respectively. Allow setback reduction from the bordered vegetative wetlands from Great Sandy Pond, from the septic tank from 100 feet down to 80 feet. So what this all means, there's an actual edge of the water and then there's a buffer zone of wetlands. That's why you have two different numbers. It's 100 feet from the actual edge of high water, but the wetlands comes up another 20, so he's only 80 feet from the wetlands. He's supposed to be 100. He's supposed to be 400 feet from this surface body of water, and he's 100, which is allowed. Then he is 100 with the tank. I'm sorry, 100 and 103. 100 with the tank and 103 with the system itself. He has jammed this system up within 7 feet of the roadway. So he's gone about the maximum he can without basically putting his septic system in jeopardy of the roadway itself and damage from it. The only other option would then be to push it across the road, which I don't want to tell anyone, but you're probably already aware the cost of a road opening permit is absolutely enormous. And then it could be, you know, in theory shifted over here, but but you're just pushing off the problem from one area to another. You're pushing it off on the
and
other body of water.
And this isn't like Taylor Point Road where they own
the road. No, this is a finished,
road.
Yeah. Well, he does, but it is a finished road. It's a finished accepted road unlike Taylor Point.
And then the dock, his dock is over here?
Yes. He owns both sides.
Mm-hmm. And for the record, which one is the drinking water supply?
Great Sandy Pond is the drinking water supply for Abington Rockland.
That's a lot of variances.
Is this a resale?
No. He is owner-occupied. He was the one that had the devastating fire. You probably saw it. It made the news.
Yeah.
Our fire chief was interviewed and everything else. It was pretty heavily damaged. Took them almost a year to return home to the connection.
And then the septic system failed?
No, but he has cesspools, and he is being proactive to fix it. He knows it's inappropriate and not up to code where he is, and where he did so much work on the house. He is upgrading the septic as well, because obviously he achieved building permits and everything else. He's been working on this plant for quite a few months, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
He's an engineer.
He is. The homeowner is an engineer. He's been working with the assistance of Morris, as this is well out of his wheelhouse.
Oh.
Unfortunately, he had several applications before one was accepted.
Can you help me to understand what you just said? He had several applications.
He made several applications before he made an application that would pass.
Several applications for the new septic?
Correct.
To
this office.
Okay.
Before he had one that would pass muster that we sent off the date frame for review that would pass.
Okay. So
in other words, we don't take someone's plan and if we see an obvious problem with it, we don't keep taking $200 from them and sending it out to Dave Primer for review. If there are obvious flaws in the plan, we bring it to the attention of the applicant so they have an opportunity to fix it before we take it in and take their money. Some towns will just take in anything and then say, if rejected, try again, and then it's another $200, and then another $200. That's very common in a lot of towns that have never been to have at this office.
Just out of curiosity, how many plans did he come? And they those.
Oh, never mind. I thought you were going to put that.
And Dave Primer has
reviewed and approved.
Is he installed, don't you?
No. He's an engineer only. And as I said, he worked with Greg Morse to work out the final details. Greg Morse is a well known, Morse Engineering is a well known engineer.
Mm-hmm.
Yet who the installer will be. I don't know if he's even gotten bids, to be honest with you. I think he's waiting for an approved plan before he signs it. That's not a problem.
So the other plans, Lisa, never made it to Dave?
No. They had obvious flaws.
Okay. And they stopped with
second
you?
Second side
right.
of tape.
Right.
No worries. Okay.
In this situation, he's met the maximum feasible setback that I think he really can achieve, and that's what we were looking for, and that's what I wanted to see him accomplish before we sent it to Dave Primer. Had he not achieved the maximum setback, that would have been the first comment from Mr. Primer, would be to reject the design and say, why didn't you move it further away from, you know, the water supply, the water body, the EPD? That would have been the first comments he would have made.
Well, I was appreciative that you asked some questions, because those are some things that I was thinking when you asked about the history here.
Mm.
And I also appreciate you sharing that some previous designs, because I'm looking at this, I'm saying, oh, holy smoke, there's
a
lot of variances here.
There's quite a few incarnations to get to this.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, for some of the pond properties, particularly on Great Sandy Pond, this is the challenge they face. On the other side of the pond, there are parcels even smaller with even less setback from the water than this.
Another question, was this home always before the fire a three bedroom
yes,
home?
Yes.
So and he is doing another three bedroom.
Correct.
At 150.
He knows that he could never increase the capacity. The nitrate loading regulation would prohibit him from ever increasing the flow to that parcel. That's a state law that he knew that was a hard cap.
Okay. Just know that was one of them.
The state does not allow, okay, so communities like ours, we're not the only one. You see this down in Plymouth and Carver, where lots of homes get built really densely along the front of waterfronts, particularly inland ponds. So the state has a regulation that does not allow for additional nitrate flow, basically human effluent, to be compiled on a parcel that cannot accommodate it. So basically, all these parcels under an acre, the state says whatever it is, that's what you're capped at. You can't add additional nitrate flow in a nitrate-sensitive area. In other words, anything that would be contributing to a water supply or a tributary to a water supply. So if you're in the, that 400, 200 feet setback, they're not going to allow you to add additional flow anyway.
And what's this block here?
I believe that's one of his parking areas. Yeah, this is a...
Is that of concrete?
Yeah, he had some sort of parking area there. I'm not sure if it was concrete or pavement, to be honest.
Given that the homeowner is the engineer, and as an engineer, you know, he knows some tricks and some tips. So the previous five designs that you looked at, were they dramatically different from...
No, this was tweaking. This was a lot of tweaking. But he's an engineer, but he is not a septic engineer by trade. He does a lot of other engineering. Most engineers will tell you our review engineer, David Primer, is about the hardest review engineer out there. That's one of the reasons we've always used him for the 20 years I've been involved with this office. So I try to, when I'm dealing with out-of-town engineers or engineers that are not familiar with Mr. Primer and knowing the regulations as I do, I try to, if you would, save them a rejected application by, if I see obvious flaws or obvious points that Mr. Primer is going to pull out, rather than see their plan rejected and have to have them reapply, I try to point it out to them. I was pretty confident when he came in with this, with the setbacks, with the variances all listed clearly. That was another thing, the variances had to be listed clearly. Achieving the maximum setbacks he could, especially with the water supply and consideration and everything else. When he basically pushed the system as far up into this corner as he could, I was pretty confident David Primer was going to decide that it was about as good as it was going to get.
What about, so test pit one was no good?
No, it was fine, but by shifting over here, if you'll notice, this is a tangential line. If you shift over here, we're going to be that much closer to the water supply.
Okay. What made you ask
The house as it is would be a buffer.
One, there were two test pits then.
There's always two test pits.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I was just curious
thinking
why they didn't.
Fail.
No.
Why
and actually, he did have it over here, and that's the first thing I pointed out. If you shift this system here, see all the angle you're taking away?
Mm-hmm.
I believe this was 80 feet from the edge of water, and I didn't think that was the first thing David Primer would say. Why, when you push it over here, one, the house acts as a block of any water runoff or any groundwater infiltration.
Mm-hmm.
Two, you could achieve another, 15, 20 feet setback by shifting it over here. It's the first thing I pointed out.
Mm, okay.
And actually, David Primer's is all just, show existing driveway, high-low venting. His comments are very routine on this particular, this particular parcel.
Well, a lot of variances, but given the fact that it has passed the muster with Mr. Primer and changes have been made, I'm going to make a motion to accept the variances as written on the property 91 Phillips Road.
I'll second that.
I'm going to refrain for lack of knowledge where this has got history and there's so much into it. I'm going to refrain from the vote.
Okay.
Did you second?
I second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And Gail has refrained.
Just as a point of interest, in favor, opposed, or abstained would probably be the terminology you'd like to use. Abstain just means you have no strong opinion or you feel like you lack the knowledge or lack the whatever.
Or there could be a conflict of interest.
Conflict of interest is another reason.
Yeah.
So those are the options that are available to you just as a point of reference.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so we have gone through all of those.
Yes.
Are we ready to update?
Sure.
About the lovely town of Pembroke.
Sure. What would you like to know about?
Well, we've got some updates.
Lisa's going to sign off the permit.
You're all set.
Okay.
Now, do you
I need
today?
To go to
CONCOM
for
that. Oh, yeah. Do you want... Do
and
you,
I could have a plan from down there.
Do we have all your plans? I feel awful now. Do we have all your plans?
Well,
I can give you one copy. Okay.
Yeah, if I could bring down and tell them it was approved.
Does the board mind if I take a quick walk down with this gentleman so I can get him moving forward?
While you were here, could you introduce yourself for the record?
You're the homeowner, right?
Yeah.
I didn't even see you sitting over there.
Oh, I...
You could have jumped in.
I wasn't supposed to say that.
Oh, goodness. No. Forgive me. Lisa Pelletti, we talked many times.
I'm John Hoare.
John, if you don't
Hi,
mind,
John.
What is your... You? I know you don't do septic as a design, but you're an engineer. What is your
well,
field
I do,
of...
Well, I've done landfills and...
Thank you. I apologize.
Yeah.
Did I massacre your plan or did I do okay?
As long as it passed, I probably have nothing else to say.
Does the board mind if I just run down quickly to make sure he's also?
No, not at all. Can I, can we skip over your updates and go right to this vote to reappoint?
If it pleases the board, I was just going to ask for my normal three-year extension since it was coming up. If that pleases the board, that's what I was going to ask for on my contract. The contract being, of course, just terms of.
That's not, that's not.
Oh, Ben Bestinelli's, yes, you can handle his.
Yeah, we're not, yeah, I don't have that.
Nope, Ben, it's on there, it's on the.
On the other side, okay. All right, so I'm just going to put the health agent's updates, which is going to be Travis, the health agent contract, and the font testing, which is going on, so Lisa will be right back. Reappointing of Ben Bestinelli to the Drainage Commission. This comes in front of the board every 3 years. His term is to be, expire on June 30th, 2019. He has been on there for 3 years or longer, Carol?
This is another term.
Couple of terms already? Okay. I have to report back. The boards do have to vote for him to be reappointed. This is something that we and you and I have, you actually weren't because of 3 years. Drainage Commission?
My first year, though,
yeah,
we, as a board, were asked to approve the nomination. I believe it was Paul Whitman.
Mm-hmm.
And our previous board member had an issue with that, and it was a little bit of an issue.
And we voted nay.
Right.
Yes.
I'm still not clear why it comes to us, the Board of Health.
Right. And it is part of our Board of Health.
Well, I get that it's probably part of our responsibility,
yeah,
but
with the drainage.
I'm surprised. I would think that the drainage committee, I don't know, I in the future would like someone to come up here and give a little explanation.
Right, because we're he's a DPW commissioner.
Yeah. And
so why?
He's appointed, he's not elected. Like there was.
Yes, he's got one appointed position. He's got one elected position.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't understand the Board of Health.
Carol, do you have any insight into that to clarify why the Board of Health? I know it's part of our.
So bring in that very brief explanation that it's kind of like a dual position. He's on the DPW, but the drainage is part of the DPW.
Can we table this for the next meeting with more clarity to go along with this?
Actually, for June 30th,
we're 16th.
Yeah.
No, we're the 13th today, so it would be the 27th.
Yeah. Can you, Sabrina's in a meeting. I don't know if that's enough time. Why don't we leave that and we'll ask Lisa if that's enough time. We can actually vote. Oh, here she comes.
For the record.
Sorry about that. I just didn't want him to be further delayed. Or
Lisa, can you explain why the Board of Health once again has to vote to reappoint
drainage.
A drainage commissioner?
Required every 3 years.
Why?
State law. I don't know. Ask the state. We've done it for as long as I've been involved.
Mm-hmm.
It's always a joint vote of the selectmen and the Board of Health. Couldn't give you an answer if my life depended on it, other than historical. I'm assuming, if you ask me to take my best educated guess, is they're looking at us to protect water. They don't want a mayor or a select board to just appoint whoever that isn't going to take due care of stormwater runoff.
When you say it's a joint vote, not that we're voting together, but it's a vote that the Board of Selectmen and the
Correct.
Board of Health must take.
Correct.
But does somebody to initiate the process, so it sounds like if I'm reading Donna's agenda correctly, Donna Bagney to bring the results to the board's majority vote to the selectmen. So
Correct.
Is the way it procedurally you understand it works, it originates with the Board of Health and then moves to the Board of Selectmen?
That is my understanding. Sometimes they will happen simultaneously. They haven't.
Okay, so let's assume that your understanding is correct. So if it originates with the Board of Health, and I ask because there was some controversy my first year on the board with with another member.
Yes.
So I guess my question is, and I wholeheartedly would endorse Ben Bestinelli to the commission. I have no issue with that whatsoever. What I'm questioning is, I'm asking either going forward, does the Drainage Commission get together and say, who's gonna do this? How, and then it comes?
Yes, they put forth a candidate.
So they, okay.
Usually it's one of the, in almost every town that I'm familiar with their operations, the ones Pembroke, it is almost always a DPW commissioner.
Okay, but it's done via the Drainage Commission?
Correct, which is usually the exact same three people in almost every town.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. In a few towns it is different, but in my experience, the health agents I work with in, say, Duxbury, Halifax, it's almost always the same commission.
And last year, we voted as a board not to accept the reappointment.
Correct.
Well, yeah. Not, I don't know if I was in favor of that. But anyway,
yes, I don't believe
well, it, no, I wouldn't go so far as calling it convoluted, but it's just one of those.
Sorry.
Nope.
It just not having the attachments, not having the state law that goes along with why we're making this decision, I'm inclined not to vote for this. I really, to me...
Can we table it? Do we have enough time if we table it till the 27th?
I guess
we
no.
Okay. I didn't think we would.
So it is a vote. Does someone have to make a motion?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to make a motion. It does feel a little convoluted to me, and I appreciate Gail's concerns, and I share them to a degree. It feels like a little bit of a rubber stamp. I know it's been done the last 2 years on the board. So given all that, I am going to make a motion to reappoint Benjamin Bassanelli to the Drainage Commission for a 3-year term.
Just so you know, this regulation, which I'm pulling up right now, goes back to 1886.
At least one of us was around.
It's very long. I can go further. If the board could give me a little more time, I'll try to find you a state statute.
Donna, we can't add
today.
That
but
to
just going
this.
Back here,
I know.
It goes
I was
back
going to have it put into the next.
We can have it put into the next.
I
can
get
you some more.
Yeah. And I would like to, I will second Gary's motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm going to abstain from the vote without the law.
Okay. And then I'm going to add that my list here.
So do you need to bring that to the board this evening, BOS?
No, I think I need to just send an email tomorrow to Sabrina Chilcott of what our vote was. Okay, so we knocked that one off the list. Okay.
You must have better vision than I, because I hate
perfect.
That seat when I was looking at
next,
septic tanks.
I
could never
see.
No, I find that interesting.
Yeah.
I can see, and I understand, but where I'm so new, Gary, and this is already stuff
have,
that's come up, and you guys have very reviewed it. It'd be stupid to make an informed decision without an informed decision.
For me on time. We're on target for delivery, actually. Toter wanted to deliver some toters early. We had given the bad news up high. Our high school is still being a high school, so no, you can't have it yet. Toters are still on mark for delivery on June 22nd. Toter still strongly feels they will make the target delivery date where they will be done with completed delivery by July 10th. Every home in Pembroke will have their toter and be ready to launch the new automated program, thus keeping in compliance with our new negotiated contract with our hauler, thus saving us somewhere in the neighborhood.
I'm excited for our new green lids.
I'm excited not to have a trash bill that's going to go up to $350 a year. Thank you very much.
Is it a green lid?
It is a green lid. So it's doesn't separate.
Doesn't
say
our
trash,
recycling, isn't our recycling one green?
No, our recycling one is black with recycling instructions printed on top.
Maybe you need stronger cheater glasses.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Your recycling bucket?
This is green.
Green.
The bucket's green. The lid is
green.
Black.
The bucket is green. The lid is black.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the lid is not important to me.
Green.
It
will be now.
The lid's on the trash.
Oh, my
God.
I know.
What?
Donna,
I'm
right.
Getting old. I'm like, no, I brought it in last week. The cover is different.
The cover is black. If you think about how high they ride in the trash trucks,
yep.
This is what some towns do, just to do the two different colors. My family also lives in Abington.
The one thing I will comment about two different colors makes for quite a kaleidoscope as you drive down the street. The one nice thing about the green toters is they kind of blend in with the vegetation. They're not as stark as, say, black or blue or hot pink, as some communities went with. They see the lids very clearly. A lot of towns, my favorite town to look at for this would be Middleborough, has, I want to say, yellow and black lids on green toters. Again, much more visually friendly. Ours will be even more visually friendly with theirs, minus the yellow. But when you're riding along the trash trucks, the two different bin colors are not as necessary because they're looking down from such a height, but they stand out very clearly. Mm-hmm.
No sarcasm intended. are we being asked when we get the two lids for trash and recycling, should one be on the right and the left, or
makes
is it,
no
it makes no difference?
As long as there's space for the arms to get in and that the bars, if you would, face out. Absolutely. Not because they're using the bars for lifting, but because that face of the toter is the stronger face of the toter. Mm. We just sent a whole bunch of handouts home with the kids to the schools, which I dropped off today, which are going home in backpacks. There's a mailer going out. There's also a hanger that will be on the toters themselves explaining all of it.
Bars closest to the street?
Yeah. Correct.
Yep.
And it really, yes, can it pick it up if it's backwards? It absolutely can, but to protect the lid and the functionality of the lid to avoid breakage if the bars face the street, the toters will last a lot longer. So if anyone's interested, these are the toter color chips that come. You'll notice our green is actually missing from the sample because they didn't have one. The lids will then be this color. The toter lids of the recycling are this toter black. So the blue is the most similar to the green we have. It's just in blue. We have the exact same chip makeup except in the green tones instead of the blue.
Awesome. Well done.
Well, we'll see. Let's hope that the rollout goes as smoothly as recycling.
I was saying well done on your involvement with this.
Yeah, I do what I can.
And is that is the information on that tag to everybody that also is the property of the town?
Yes, it is.
And it needs to, on resale, on resale, it has to be left on the property because it goes with the sale of the home.
We're doing everything we can to educate people, yes. Okay. And there's another episode of Ed TV, if you would, that's going to talk about that. And actually, Easy is putting together a video clip showing the truck going along, picking up to help educate people as to why you do certain things, why to face the barrels of the street and everything else. Okay. They're going to shoot a little video clip of actually picking up some things and stuff like that. They were also willing to do a touch a truck event for the kids that do think this is really cool to come out and see it and everything else. They're working on organizing that as well.
Nice. Okay. All right. Health agent contract.
Is there another copy of my contract? Should we
I don't think I saw it either.
That's right.
Do you have it?
No, I don't believe so.
Yep.
I didn't have one.
So every 3 years I'm appointed. I know it was asked about, so there it is. The board may be aware. So interestingly enough, yes, I answer to the Wage and Personnel Committee. The board only gets to extend my contract to actually work here. Normally this week we take this up right around the first of the year. That's what we've done historically, but if we want to take it up early, that's just fine with me. I'd be looking for the same 3-year extension. As you're aware, I went before Wage and Personnel along with several other staff members to ask a raise, which was voted at town meeting floor. The board cannot, the board can offer me employment. You cannot negotiate my duties. You cannot negotiate my rate of pay. That is done by the Wage and Personnel Board. I work at the will of this board, but my compensation is not under control of this board, which is true of myself and a few other department heads that are non-union personnel. Obviously, union personnel's job descriptions and remuneration is handled by their union negotiations.
And you also share a few other hats in this town in regard.
I share a great number of hats in this town, yes.
Yes, you do.
I also work on the IT committee. I obviously work on the trash and recycling. If you wanted to consider strictly duties of the Board of Health, you'd want to stick to strictly waste control, as in illegal dumping, that sort of thing. You'd want to stick towards the Title V, the public health controls, and the inspectional services that pertain to public health controls. That is strictly what an agent would do. Oh, and emergency management, I should not forget that. That's obviously a huge portion of what
Absolutely.
I do. Beyond that, things that I do that are not strictly quote-unquote necessary. I serve on the local state advisory committee as elected by my peers. I represent all of Plymouth County to the state, LEMA, and DPH on a regular basis. represent us to the HHMC. Needless to say, this is beginning to be a lot, but my peers have seen fit to keep nominating me to represent them in pretty much every aspect of emergency management the Board of Health would partake in, whether it be inoculation, sheltering, things like that, and I do so with the endorsement of the police and the fire chief. So that could be strictly pared down if one wanted to. The IT committee, I was part of the fundamental group that insisted that at some point we had to have a backup system in this town hall. We existed on such a plane that should we lose anyone's personal computer, and we had 2 15-year-old servers, if we lost them, we were going to lose all data in the town of Pembroke. As this board is aware, of bringing the community up to speed, that can no longer happen. We have a full multi-layered server with 24-hour backup, backup to the cloud, and remote backup. What not a lot of people are aware, the town of Pembroke just 3 months ago underwent a cyber attack. And it was an aggressive cyber attack. It was a cyber attack from which some companies have not recovered. But Hubtech successfully, with our platform, got us out of it. Our entire data and server was taken hostage for ransom. And a ransom with demand was made. Mm-hmm. And we recovered thanks to the quick work of myself, Ms. Chilcott, and our group at Hubtech to contain that virus, have that virus removed, have that computer triple scrubbed, actually 7 layers of scrubbing, which I never knew. And I continue to serve on that committee today. Luckily, that is not a huge absorption of my time. I'm the chair of that committee, but if the board wishes and wants to redirect me, that could be given up. Trash and recycling, I work with the town administrator specifically because of my historical knowledge. No one's been working on trash and recycling as long in this community as I have due to my years of working with this board. I've always worked on a very positive level with the Office of the Board of Selectmen on these issues, as well as Mike Valente. Again, if this is something you want to step away from, we can step away from it. I don't think that's in the best interest of the taxpayers. In my observation working here in the town hall in the last 6 years, it's changed. It's not enough to play one tune or sing one song. There is almost not a department head in this town hall that does strictly what their outlined work is. For example, Kathleen McCarthy, the treasurer collector, also serves on the IT committee. She's also chair of the committee that's leading up the what I want to get talking about later, but the Furnace Pond Dredging Project will be the single largest environmental reclamation that the town of Pembroke will do or ever has done that I'm aware of. So there's someone that, you know, who's a treasurer collector that does something like that, but she has to step up because she's working with us on the numbers, on the bids, to make sure that we can actually financially work something like that out. Kathy Sam is the treasurer, he's the chief assessor, but she also serves on the IT committee. She also works on a couple other levels. Obviously, Mr. Coyne's involved in almost everything. Mike Buckley often sits in on some of these different meetings to offer his expertise. The one thing I can say, for example, on emergency management, yes, sheltering and mass inoculation is ours, but we've never entertained a drill or an exercise that the two chiefs haven't been at. They've been at all of them, as some of the board has been through some of the walkthroughs in our high school. Erin Obey, she's a superintendent. She was an assistant superintendent. She also serves on PEMA, our emergency management group. Mm-hmm. It would be my opinion that the days of being a one-tune singer or a one-job description employee in a town this size at the staffing level we're at is non-existent. I don't think it can be done. For this town to be successful, everyone has to go above and beyond. I pride myself in that. I'm happy to do above and beyond, and I will do above and beyond whenever I can. But if it's the will of the board that we move in a different direction, then we can move in a different direction.
Any questions that pertain directly to this item?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Is this on the agenda? This was put on the agenda by you? Well,
my understanding
okay.
is it was requested to be
okay.
on the agenda
mm-hmm.
through previous requests.
Okay.
Yes.
Did you put it on the agenda?
I did.
Okay. So just help me to understand. Did you put it on for us to vote or to?
We can either vote. When is it up, Lisa?
It's up March 27th.
Of 2017 next year.
Right. So we can vote with the new board in place. We can
promptly, I believe,
wait.
The way to do it would be within 30 to 60 days prior to the contract. Or I think it's 60 to 90 days prior to the contract. I know it's one of them to re-sign the contract. We're signing it now a year ahead of time.
I would like to make a motion to table this for a potential vote at our next Board of Health meeting.
hearing.
I'm going to look up and see what the regulations are for the overlap.
I have no problem stating for the record, I wholeheartedly endorse in my years, 2 years on the board, what our health agent has done. And going above and beyond is a phrase that I would concur that our current health agent does. But I think it behooves us to at least...
To stay within the law of how we're supposed to do this.
Yes, to stay within the law. But if we're able to, and I guess we're going to find out if we're able to vote, but if we're able to vote on this next week, I think everybody should have the opportunity to do so. So if we are within the law...
And I will send a message to Sabrina.
Okay.
I will ask her for that specific law where it is and have it provided, and it will be, so we're going to table this to the next meeting with paper backup.
Well, you're, correct me if I'm wrong, you're going to find out through speaking with the town administrator's assistant if we are able to vote on it. If we are able to vote on this now, I would like to make a motion to table this for a vote for next week.
Well, we can't make a motion to, we don't have the proper paperwork to do so. This is March 24th, 2014. We don't even have the proper paperwork to...
Well, this is the existing contract. The contract isn't going to change.
Correct, but the members are going to change.
Yeah.
And
the dates... from the board for me. That's the letter I received from the board after the vote was taken that I was extended a contract. That's the contract I'm extended.
Okay, so until 2017.
Correct.
Right. So I do know that there is, from my days at Medicare, I do know that there is a statute in between a contract being signed. You can't sign a contract a year and a half for a year and a half away. Okay.
Yeah, and that's 9 months away.
I'm gonna,
it's not a year and a half away, it's 9 months away.
Okay, well there's still a statute, so we're gonna look that up.
Correct.
Not a year and a half.
So let's
talk to Sabrina.
Thank you. I am. I'm going to send Sabrina an email or come in tomorrow. I'm going to ask her what we're looking for. I will send that to you, both of you, and I'll decide whether we're gonna put it on the agenda, but right now it's tabled.
Okay.
Can I just get a second for it to be tabled?
Who made the motion?
I'm asking you to make a motion that we
table
this.
The next meeting. And
again, I think I made that motion.
Okay, then I'm going to second it.
Sorry.
All in favor?
All in favor.
Aye. Table. Okay, so I'm going to put this back in the purple, the light purple, the lilac folder. Okay.
Light fuchsia.
There you go. Okay, how are our ponds doing?
Knock on wood, they're looking good. First round of testing went splendid. Turbidity is only up at furnace, but we know furnaces are a problem with pond. It needs extra love and care. Next round of testing will be next tomorrow, and porta-johns just went out at all our public beaches. Except for Old Port, which has a real john, which is now repaired and working wonderfully.
Okay, what's up with Old Home?
What do you mean? We had a porta-john there last year because there was a breakage of the pipe, and the pipe tank, and we couldn't do the work to repair it. Now that
is there any treatment going on with Alden?
All done.
Alden, what was that treatment?
Alan. For this freshman coffee.
A little Sandy, okay?
A little Sandy, knock on wood, and Stetson are crystal clear.
Good.
And perfect. Turbidity, which is just the cloudiness at furnaces high. We have no illegal contaminants, nothing triggering any kind of shutdown or anything. Just overall turbidity is high.
Mm-hmm.
So it is cloudy out there.
Okay. Got anything else for us?
How do we want to handle urgent, urgent variances, urgent items that come up?
I think that we should, as a chair, I think that we should handle them the same way that we have been handling them. When they come to your attention, you sent through a extremely detailed email on the situation. I understand why you...
I had no knowledge of that, so that there was...
Right.
For me to vote would have been false, so...
Right. So, but with the explanation that you gave...
Are you still comfortable with this? I will always cite the property, the variance being sought, and why it's being sought. The reason, but I just want the board to understand, just so you understand that... I apologize. Rebecca, you understand completely. You're a realtor. When these homes come up, unfortunately, the new trend, because of people spending cash out of pocket, and I understand when you're liquidating a home, it is very difficult to come up with, say, $20,000 out of pocket to be able to convey your property. But nonetheless, without the certificate of compliance being achieved a week before closing, someone can't go to closing on their house, which means they have to come up with cash, which means often these property owners are not waiting until they have their property under agreement to then spend this money into the system. This, unfortunately, means the engineers and myself are under the gun to get a perk test done, get a design done, get it out to data primer, get it back, get it approved, and God forbid if there's a variance, as happened on Forest Street. It's an antique house, finished basement, the pipe came out low, the groundwater's high on Forest Street. That was the only variance. The system was full size, the system was compliant, the system met the setback to the property. Everything else about it was great. But by bringing it another foot out of the ground, it would have been quite unsightly. This way, it was able to be blended in naturally. The foot in groundwater meant that they didn't have to add additional treatment, do additional landscaping work to the front of the house. Unfortunately, the problem is these situations are going to come up a lot, and they're going to come up in between meetings, and the failure to get these systems signed off and in the ground, which can often be done in 2 days. This system that was installed by Smith was started on a Monday and completed by Tuesday afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is if we wait, the homeowner that's made an agreement to sell cannot go to closing and will lose anywhere, Donna, correct me, from $5,000 to $15,000, depending on what their closing agreement was, by not making that target date. Meaning they just handed a check to a potential buyer for not making their property available to convey at that point, and or
also
lose the sale.
It also means, it also means now with the new TRID law that was passed as of October 1st, for complete documentation of all monies that are transferring within hands, I have to have a final water reading done minimum of 12 days before the sale date.
Mm-hmm.
12 days. We have to do a final water and a paid receipta. Of the final electric reading has to be done. If those do not fall in the hands of the mortgage lender within their 10 days, then when they are submitted, it re-kicks it back out 72 hours, and the whole file for the buyer has to go through to underwriting again, and then a new date set. Now, the water has gone past 10 to 12 days. Sometimes the smoke certificate, has expired, so that has to be redone, plus another $50 to have it done. This system, this septic system, needed a Title V compliance to the mortgage company before...
And it had a 4-day window.
Right.
To be done, to get that certificate.
And if we had waited for what was going to be our next meeting, which would have been...
The 13th today.
Today.
Right.
This homeowner... and the buyer would have had to have waited. Now stuff is already scheduled to be put in moving trucks. There's probably another sale from the seller is selling and then going on to another home. It's just a domino effect.
I understand that. My husband and I own two homes. I am very well aware of the legal ramifications that can happen,
mm-hmm.
and all of the different scenarios that can fall into that. My only thing is for me to take a vote on any kind of a variance on a septic. I really feel that I should have full knowledge, far too young into the board, to know what's been discussed or to have anything that you guys have reviewed in the past for me to be up to speed with it.
Mm-hmm.
Until I get comfortable with what we're reviewing and the special requirements that are coming along,
mm-hmm.
I will probably stay with the no vote on those kind of variances,
yep.
until I'm assured that I know full scale that we're in compliance with everything.
Okay. And that's fine. We're going to continue sending out, especially condemnations.
Okay.
There are issues when the fire department will arrive at a home and the health agent is notified immediately.
Mm-hmm.
There are times when real estate agents walk into homes and they're going to show a home and they're just like, oh my God, notification has to be made.
Correct.
So with all that being said, we'll keep what we have going. You know, any questions that come up, you certainly can ask. Please interject. We will get you the information. Something that Gary found very, very helpful when he started was he actually went out and saw a Title V inspection.
I've seen Title V.
An installation being done. You know, the lingo, the verbiage, you know, definitely is something that you, it takes SAA, you know, soil absorption system. It's all that. But with that being said, I want to keep it as we have been doing, and that's okay if mm-hmm. you abstain, because Gary, he's going to either negate what I do.
The both of you have the knowledge of prior septics that have come up, prior
some
things
them,
that have been rejected.
Mm-hmm.
The new ones, certainly I'll follow. I'll start off with the new ones with you, and then we'll move from there.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay.
In terms of emergency decisions that our health agent is making, and I'm aware there are some towns on the South Shore where the boards of health have actually given the health agent the latitude to make an emergency decision. So I think Pembroke, we as a board have been smart. We've been caught. I think we've been cautiously intelligent in that we have directed our health agent to, when an emergency situation is put forth to her, that she makes that phone call and reaches out to the members. So I don't think, you know, we're not giving carte blanche to the health agent. We're asking for that phone call. She's presenting us with the information. So I concur, I mean, I'm giving a mouthful, but I concur that we continue what we've been doing, where you have reached out to us, Lisa, and we have been able to vote on that. As I think it's not a case of some town just abdicating.
I think you made a good word.
I'm full of awesomeness. I make up lots of words. I think we haven't abdicated our responsibility to the health agent, but we've given her the ability to make it, you know, to reach us to us and have that emergency vote. So,
well, and that's the role of the Board of Health. Yeah. Several years ago, we had a septic failure on an apartment, and actually, Lisa was chair at that time, and everybody got relocated. She contacted the health agent. Fred contacted Lisa, and they were all put into a hotel for the evening.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
So
this is the board. This is the board's funding.
Absolutely.
I'm on TV sticking out my tongue.
Yeah, I know.
That's
okay. But yes.
So yes, these are definite criteria that we need to address immediately. I fully agree with that.
And being on the other side now of being a board member versus clerical portion, there is definitely a learning curve of learning all these different things and components and different engineers and how things are presented and all
my
of these.
My challenge is where I need to get more fluent is into the septic.
Yep.
As far as the rules,
section on
I have a book
Title
at home.
Five.
My husband bought me one for dummies.
Oh, good.
Oh, yeah.
Good. What a great guy.
Yeah. Great read.
No,
I'll be sitting in my white Adirondack chair.
Mm-hmm. All right,
it's better to read it than smell it.
All right. It looks like you're packing up. Do we want to go through the rest of these things?
Okay. I didn't know if we were. Yep.
Yep. I just want to make sure we hit on them, because if not, I can always turn around and put them on the next meeting's agenda.
All right.
The authoritative role of the Board of Health will be located in everyone's appointed committee policy handbook and procedures. Oh. That is listed under item number one of the appointed committee handbook. Basically what came into question was about setting the agenda
calling for special meetings, signing documents did not come up. Chairperson has the same rights and responsibilities as other members to other offer resources, make and second in motion. We also have a clerk's position. In this, because we have a secretary, the secretary's absence, the clerk would then be responsible for taking and preparing the minutes of the meeting. Okay? I know that you tried diligently to keep up with the last meeting, but there was an awful lot, and we had the tape recording, so...
Despite the challenges, my notes for those minutes were flawless, Madam Chair.
I didn't expect anything less, Mr. Fine.
Thank you.
You're welcome. discussion of ethics course, training for new board members. Was there not a website that you had sent through?
It's on a conference right now. May have MAHB, Mass Association of Health Boards. Would it be helpful if I forwarded all the board members a link to that site?
That would
be
wonderful.
There's online training, and God willing, please, they will again in November do that in-depth training, which is where this book comes from, which I made sure that every board member has a copy of.
That's
this
the one up in Taunton, the all-day?
Yes, yeah. The all-day one on Saturday in Taunton. Mm-hmm. That book was put together with the advice of Cheryl Savara, very well-known, and as you saw, we talked about the tobacco attorney for public health. She worked for the state for quite a while. She now works for tobacco control groups. Talks about everything under the sun. There's a whole course that Gary attended for new board of health members that Mr. Driscoll attended. I think you had already been on for a while, so you did the more advanced class, which got into a lot more of the emergency management.
Yeah.
And some legal. You had a lot of legal classes as well. I, of course, was doing the emergency management, some housing emergency course. I also had an emergency course on mass pandemic. That I attended at the last round, so I'm looking forward to, and God willing, they would do that again. I know the funding is getting really tight. There does stand the chance that it would be canceled. I sincerely hope not, but one of the better courses I've ever attended.
Okay.
The ethics course, we should all be doing this once a year. We should be doing this online once a year.
Yes.
Actually, we are going to be notified by the clerk. She sends it to every secretary, and it's coming up.
I know that's a government, because I worked for Medicare A for...
And has everyone done the open meeting law? One? It's required to be done by every appointed elected official within 2 weeks of their appointment election.
Yep.
You have to sign a form and return it to the clerk.
Yep, that would be for Gail.
Yep.
Yep. I talked to Marianne today. She's going to be sending out all the information to every single department within the town. And the sites that we all have to log into, and yes, the ethics course has to be done every year.
It's a once a year, unless they've changed that law, but that one was.
Yep.
That's what I usually say.
Voting procedures and requirements available to the board of three. So voting, we have three. We are a small board. All we need are two votes to be able to pass.
To make
anything.
A quorum. Yep.
The summer schedule for the Board of Health meetings. In your packet, we have the list of what the selectmen follow. I advised earlier on why we do that, why it is in the best interest of the boards as well
summer
as
schedule.
The taxpayers.
Here it is.
For the town of Pembroke. This is an agenda that they're going to follow.
Okay.
It is falling in line with our June 13th. They're just doing every 2 weeks.
Are we going to do the June 27th?
Yes, I would like to.
That would.
Board of Health meeting every 2 weeks.
Okay.
Yes, which is something we've always done, with the exception of.
Okay, if we're going to do that, then why don't we get some clarity on Benjamin Bassanelli? Because we're there asking June 30th, and we can squeeze him in on the 27th. For Mr. Bassanelli's vote.
I think we already voted on that.
They did vote to do it.
Okay.
Do you want to meet him?
The 27th is not enough time for the information to get to this, for June 30th, to the selectman's office. even though we're meeting Monday, they won't get it until the 28th. It's 2 days before. They're looking for a vote for tonight.
Okay.
And we have voted.
Yep, you did. I abstained. You two voted.
Correct.
Yep.
And that was one of the things we said, was there going to be enough time?
Right, I just had the
June 30th.
So June 27th, we're date?
Yep.
Next meeting.
You know, I would like, I know it's a three-year appointment, right?
So yeah.
I would like going forward, if and when the Drainage Commission, and it's not an if, it's when the Drainage Commission makes a motion to appoint someone, to be Drainage Commissioner, that they come before the board.
And I believe that was asked last time it was voted for.
Okay.
I do believe that was a question for you.
For me? Or from me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Not knowing at that point in time.
Yes.
You know, knowing the individual, but not understanding what a drainage commissioner is and what do they do. But with that being said, I think that is a great note. I think I'll reach out to
Ben.
We've elected him. We have reappointed him. I'd like to, Carol, see if he can come to one of our meetings and introduce himself and tell us what he does. I think that would be interesting.
Yes, it is.
Summer schedule. With everybody taking a look at it, I know that we have vacations in there.
Mm-hmm.
To the best of your knowledge, do you think that we can all make these meetings?
The only one I might have difficulty with is August 8th.
Okay.
I can tell the board with certainty I will miss two of them. I'm away the week of July 11th, and I'm away the week of August 27th. I can prepare written statements if you'd like, and certainly if there's plans to be reviewed that might have variances or such that are associated with them, I can tell the engineers that they are, quote unquote, on their own to come in and present their own projects to you. Obviously, as a courtesy, I have presented many engineers, not only the dogs right there, many engineering projects for them to save them the time and therefore save the client money, but I can simply put them on notice that they should come in and present their own.
Okay, and then if you're not there, I'm sure that we have other things that...
Oh, no, I'll hear your whole written thing, but yes, I mean, obviously...
But we also, right, we can also maybe do some different backfill with things that don't require you, but as a board. Okay, perfect. All right, I'm pretty good with this. So we understand why we like to follow the selectmen's summer schedule. Do we have any further discussion, or can I get a motion?
Are you looking for a motion to close the meeting?
Is that what you meant?
For a motion to follow the summer schedule. I'll give you a motion to follow the selectmen's schedule.
You can go right behind that with the next motion.
Okay.
Without delay.
Gary, how about this? I give a motion to follow the selectman's schedule for the summer.
Sure, I'll second that motion.
Okay.
All in favor? Aye.
Okay, now Gary.
Okay, before we make a motion to adjourn, I just want to update my two colleagues on the board. At our meeting last week, I was asked to have a discussion on the ruling of the two complaints. So the attorney has forwarded me her response to the Attorney General on the two complaints that were made. One of them has already gone into the Attorney General, so I had a lengthy discussion on her report. There were some edits that I had suggested she had made. I will be emailing her or calling her tomorrow, because tomorrow the second complaint must be sent to the Attorney General. So,
okay.
Well, just to let you guys know. You will, I believe, to my two board members.
Yep. I gave it to you.
You both will have access to the responses that the attorney has prepared.
Okay.
For the Attorney General. And that was one of my questions. I said, geez, are you guys going to have an opportunity to see it? So you will, after they've been sent.
After they've been sent.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming that they are going to come through to you or to
I'm not sure if
Ed Thorne's office?
I'm not 100% sure. I didn't have
okay.
that discussion with the attorney.
Okay. Now, Gail, I am not seeing yours. So if you could check again.
I shall.
Gary, do you have anything you want to, or you can think about it and send it through to me for the 27th, Carol, which will be our next meeting, of any item agendas you would like to see discussed in further meetings?
I do not have any at this such time.
Okay. Super.
Oh, so one last point. I think you mentioned the other 369 Washington Street did perk successfully, class 2 soil. That is the parcel of town meeting voted to buy that may or may not be developed for an emergency management slash fire station slash.
So it parked, but has a soil analysis
yes, it
been
has.
Done?
Yes, right now everything is positive at this point.
First test?
Merrill,
positive or negative?
Positive. Good, good, good.
Put it in your red envelope?
Perk of first one test?
No, the perk test, the perk test soils, wetlands, all of it. It. Right now everything is coming up positive on that parcel. So we are happy about that.
One, three, chair.
No, and I don't have
it
either.
Here's our piece of paper that is handwritten by Gail with her thoughts for what she'd like to see.
For agenda items?
Yeah, this is not
Oh, okay.
Stuff
I didn't
you check your file just in case it got.
Yeah, I didn't notice any handwritten notes. I'll
yeah.
double check.
All right, well, there were two of them.
There were two questions, yes, two requests. And didn't I give you a copy of the meeting law? I thought I did that as, yep, right now.
Yeah, and we're going to put the meeting law in the folder that Carol has for the next agenda meeting.
Right.
Now what is this?
Oh, wait a minute, hold on.
You got me?
Well, I got you.
Okay.
Yep, and I've got the room, so I'm going to put it in
okay.
the file. If you
Wonderful.
Could, if you could all leave your folders and take the paperwork. I know, I'm a pain in the neck, but we are getting...
A pain in the
spiffy
neck.
Around here.
Maybe a little bit lower than the neck, but.
And Gail, do you want to make a copy of your notes by chance?
Oh.
Just in case.
Can I bring back a new folder?
I will provide another green folder.
Would you mind?
Not at all.
Thank you. I didn't realize I shouldn't have written on my folder.
No worries. We're just trying to keep everything in order because we've got.
All righty.
What is this? Is this something?
Yes, that's the sheet of paper that I was looking for. May I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn?
At 8:14 p.m. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.